गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
कैन यू सी द स्लाइड? कैन
यस सर.
स्लाइड एंड आल्सो द कर्सर यू आर सीइंग माय कर्सर आल्सो.
यस सर.
यस सर.
ओके देन वी विल स्टार्ट. We are talking about the regulation of gene expression, and in regulation of gene expression, we have explained in most of the cases of prokaryotic genes, and in that we say that all, even in eukaryotic case, all the cells consist of the same gene or the same set of genes, but some genes are expressed in some sort of cells and the other. Genes are expressed in other types of cells, and genes are also temporally specific. That means certain genes are active during the embryonic stage, certain genes in childhood, and other genes in the adult stage. That was known as temporal specificity, and we also talked about the spatial specificity. That means some genes which are expressed in one type of tissue are not expressed in other types of tissue. And we also classified genes into two types with respect to their expression. One is the constitutive or housekeeping genes, and the other ones are controllable or inducible genes. Constitutive or housekeeping genes means those genes which are usually activated or they are transcribing, such as the genes involved in the TCA cycle. That means for the production of proteins involved in TCA cycle. And certain other types of genes which are inducible genes are activated on demand. And we talked about the operon. Operon is a coordinated unit of gene expression in case of bacteria. And we also discussed about the lac operon concept. That means the lactose metabolizing proteins are the products of lac gene, which consists of Z, Y, and A, and all the three proteins have the same promoter and the regulatory sequences. And we studied in different scenario where glucose and lactose both are present, and when only lactose is present, and in conditions when lactose is absent, how the gene is regulated. And this is the best studied example so far, the lac operon concept. And this lac operon we'll move to the gene expression in eukaryotes. gene expression in eukaryotes, as well as we'll move to the gene regulation. If we're going to the gene regulation, we're talking some important notes about the gene expression. And gene expression in eukaryotes is not that simple as that of prokaryotic case. Because of the structural features, we can see the large genome, monocystone type, repeated sequences are present, and the genes are splitted. That means exons and introns are present. The high degree of complexity of eukaryotic genomes, as well as the presence of a nuclear membrane, necessitates a wider range of regulatory processes. And as with the prokaryotes, the primary site of regulation is at the level of transcription. Now, however, more regulation are also present after transcription in the case of eukaryotes. As we compare in case of prokaryotes, that mainly was and the initiation of transcription, whereas in the eukaryotic cases we can find a large number of regulatory mechanisms after that point also. Again, the theme of transacting molecules binding with cis-actin elements in C in eukaryotic also, as we have already seen the case in prokaryotes. Okay, operons, however, are not found in eukaryotes, which must use alternative strategies to solve the problem of how to coordinately regulate the genes required for a specific response. Just like in the case of prokaryotes, we have studied about the lac operon, and that lac operon would regulate for the enzymes which are required for the lactose metabolism. That means there was a case of operon, but in eukaryotes there are no cases of operon. rarely we can find operands. In eukaryotes, gene expression is also regulated at multiple levels other than transcription, as we have said. And the transcription and translation are separated in the case of eukaryotes. In the case of prokaryotes, you can see when the mRNA is being formed at the same time, sorry, proteins can also be formed. At the same time, protein synthesis can start. That means before the end of transcription of the mRNA, when the mRNA is being formed, at the same time, translation can also occur. But this is not the case in eukaryotic case, because after the formation of mRNA, there are certain post-transcriptional modification, and it has to go to the cytoplasm before it is translated into proteins. That means naturally there would be more steps of regulation. This figure also shows you the same thing in the prokaryotes and eukaryotes. You can see for most genes, the main site of control is transcription of the DNA to RNA. And this is true for eukaryotes as well as for prokaryotes. But in case of eukaryotes, there are other sites also where the regulation occurs. But in prokaryotes, this is the major one. Others we can neglect, but in the eukaryotic case, we cannot neglect the regulation at the other sites also. Just like in transcription and formation of mRNA, and mRNA after the formation of heteronuclear RNA, formation of mature mRNA, and formation of proteins, and after the formation of proteins also, post-translational modification. At all the points, this regulation may occur. Let's see about the regulation features. RNA polymerase are of three types: type 1, type 2, and type 3 for different RNAs. As we have seen that there was no such in the prokaryotic case, but in the eukaryotic case, we have three different RNA polymerase to form tRNA, mRNA, and ribosomal RNA. And we have extensively studied about the type 2 RNA polymerase type 2. Which is to produce the mRNA. And there is also the changes of chromatin structure. Chromatin structure, they can be acetylated or deacetylated, and there can be methylation and demethylation. Okay, this acetylation and deacetylation usually occurs in the histone proteins, and this methylation in the bases. The DNA in higher organism is extensively folded and packed to form protein DNA complex called chromatin. And this chromatin is a nuclear protein. Why this chromatin is a nuclear protein? Because it consists of DNA and the protein. That's why this is a nuclear protein. And transcriptionally active chromosome is structurally distinct from inactive chromosome. How it is distinct is we'll see. Sorry. Transcriptionally active chromosome is structurally distinct from inactive chromosome. Genes with highly packed chromosomes are usually not expressed. Genes with highly packed heterochromatin are usually not expressed, whereas the less condensed chromatin is expressed, and this is known as euchromatin. And this is the highly packed is known as heterochromatin. Genes with highly packed heterochromatin are usually not expressed, whereas less condensed chromatin, which are called euchromatin, are usually expressed. Okay, transcriptionally active chromosome is structurally distinct from the inactive chromosome also. As we can see, highly packed chromosome, heterochromosomes, are not usually expressed, whereas the loosely packed or loosely condensed chromatin are known as euchromatin, and they are generally expressed. Because this loosely packed chromatin, they will give the space for different types of enzymes to come and bind. That's why there is the chance of expression. Whereas in the case of heterochromatin, they are highly condensed, highly packed, and there is no accessible for different enzymes of the process. We have talked about histone acetylation and deacetylation, and also about the methylation of DNA. Let's see how they alter. In histone acetylation, acetyl groups are attached to the positively charged lysine in histone tails. We know about the histone. Histone are the proteins associated with the eukaryotic DNA, and these histones are arranged in the octameric form. We have already discussed. And in this octameric form of histone, they have a tails protruding outwards, known as the histone tails. And these tails are the sites where they are acetylated. In histone acetylated, acetyl groups are attached to the positively charged lysine in histone tails. Actually, these histone tails, they are positively charged, and due to the positive charge, they had the affinity with negatively charged DNA. Now, what happens during DNA acetylation? This positive charge will be masked by the acetyl group, negatively charged group. Now, there will be the loosening of this tightly packed structure. This you can see, this is the unacetylated histone in the packed structure, well, as acetylated histones causes the loosely packed of the octamer units. Okay, in histone acetylation, acetyl groups are attached to positively charged lysine in histone tails. This process loosens chromatin structure, thereby promoting the initiation of transcription. Okay, these are the unacetylated histones, these are the acetylated histones. Unacetylated histones, that means in their tails, they are not acetylated. That means the positive charge in their tail is not neutralized by this acetyl groups, negative acetyl groups. That's why they have a high affinity with the DNA material. That's why they are tightly packed. Now what happens? This positive charge of lysine in histone tails, they are acetylated. That means some sort of neutralization. And if, when there is some sort of neutralization, then they will have the less affinity to the DNAs. So there will be the uncoiling. And when uncoiling, there will be the space for all the enzymes to come and act. That means after acetylation, there will be the uncoiling, and they will go for the other processes like transcription. Okay. We're talking about the histone acetylation. When histone is acetylated, they neutralize the somewhat positive charge of the tails. Now, when they neutralize the somewhat positive charge, then now DNA gets loosely packed. Earlier, they were tightly packed. Now, they are loosely packed. This is the consequence of histone acetylation. That means histone acetylation favor for transcription. Next is the methylation, just the opposite of acetylation. There is the methylation. Why opposite? Because it has the opposite influence. Methylation can condense chromatin. That means when methylated, chromatin can be condensed. When acetylated, when there was acetylation in the histone proteins, then they were loosely packed. However, when there is methylation, this methylation causes the DNA to pack tightly. Methylation can condense chromatin, results in the unavailability of gene for transcription factor. Why methylation causes the chromatin to condense? Because of the binding of methyl cytosine binding proteins to methylated DNA. Once the DNA are methylated, then methyl cytosine binding proteins will bind with the DNA and they became more condensed. Okay, we are talking about the methylation. Methylation can condense chromatin, results in the unavailability of gene for transcription factors. And this occurs due to binding of methyl cytosine binding proteins to methylated DNA. Because once the DNA are methylated, now proteins will bind to them and they form the condensed structure. And methylation of DNA has been found to correlate with deacetylation of histones. That means this provides a double means of repression of the genes. Methylation and deacetylation. Next one is acetylation and demethylation. This provides a double means of repression of the genes. Okay, now we were talking about the heterochromatin and the euchromatin. Lessly condensed chromatin are called the euchromatin, which are generally expressed. That means they are available for the transcription. Whereas the heterochromatin, they are tightly packed and they are not available for transcription, or they are not usually expressed. Why this happens is heterochromatin, formation of heterochromatin, you can see due to the formation of acetyl groups. Due to the formation of acetyl groups, that means when acetyl groups are attached, now they will uncoiled, but due to the formation of methylation process, that methylation process with condense, okay, due to this acetylation and methylation process, then can be the formation of heterochromatin and euchromatin. And we have said that histone acetylation will loosen the chromatin structure and favor for transcription, whereas methylation will favor the formation of the condensed form, and they do not favor for transcription. In this way, they regulate the gene expression. Next one would be the post-transcriptional modification. Talking about the regulation of gene expression, that means how proteins are formed and how they act. And in this process, post-transcriptional modification can also occur. That means after the formation of mRNA, there are certain post-transcriptional modification, and that modification levels can also be regulated. And next are the regulation through intracellular and intercellular signals. Okay, and in the case of regulation, we have different types of elements which we have already gone through earlier also. There are specific DNA sequences of each of which regulate transcription. They usually have the consensus sequence. We had talked about the Tata box, Cat box, and GC box. And this Cat box, Tata box, and the GC box, and the Tata box in eukaryotes we are talking now, it is also known as the Huggins box. Okay, this Cat box, it is the binding site for Cat binding transcription factor and enhancer binding protein. Then we are talking about the regulation, and in this talking about the regulation, we are just talking in brief about the consensus sequences which already discussed. That means due to the presence of those consensus sequence also, there can be proper regulation. GC box, and this GC box, it is the binding site of the protein, specificity protein 1. Specificity protein 1 is the transcription factor. These are the consensus sequences. Here different types of transcription factors will bind, and such sites can also regulate the gene expression. That means we are talking about the consensus sequence, that saying that these are also the sites where expression of gene can be regulated. And now other ones are the enhancers. Enhancer is the DNA sequence that can determine the temporal and spatial specificities of expression and increase the promoter activity. That means enhancer are the DNA sequences which are usually present in the upstream sequence, and they can determine the temporal as well as spatial specificities of expression. Temporal means age related, and spatial means tissue specific. Others can be the silencer, negative regulation DNA sequence, which can where the repressor molecules can bind. Others are the transacting factors. Transacting factors means other genes which are active, and they produce the proteins, and that proteins will bind at the region of promoter regions, as we have seen in the case of prokaryotic gene. While studying about the lac operon also, there was the inhibitory gene. Inhibitory gene was expressed and protein was produced, and that proteins would normally bind to the oppressor site. And that was an example of transacting factors, though in the prokaryotic case. They are the proteins that bind indirectly to cis-acting elements and then regulate the transcription initiation. And this can be other transcription factors too. Okay, while talking about the exact points in gene regulation, we'll talk about these points. If we have to explain about the gene regulation in prokaryotic case, we explain about the lac operon concept. But that static concept is not there in case of eukaryotic cells, as the process is highly complex. But in the case of eukaryotes, we'll explain with the help of the following mechanisms. Gene regulation in prokaryotes, that means we'll immediately think of the lac operon concept, and we'll explain the lac operon concept. However, in gene regulation in eukaryotes, we'll go for gene amplification, gene rearrangement, RNA processing, alternative mRNA splicing, transport of mRNA from nucleus to cytoplasm, regulation of mRNA stability. These are the different mechanisms which regulate the gene expression, and we'll try to understand each of them. RNA processing, we have already studied earlier also in post transcriptional modification and transport of mRNA from nucleus to cytoplasm. We already know regulation of mRNA stability. We already know capping and the trailing processes. Now we'll slightly explain about the gene amplification, the rearrangement, and alternative splicing. Okay, we're talking about the gene regulation in prokaryotes. We have to explain about the lac operon concept and all the conditions of lac operon concept. Now, the gene regulation in eukaryotes is a highly complex process. So we'll explain in terms of different mechanisms. What can control? Now, gene amplification. We know that amplification is the increasing number. Gene amplification, example in fruit fly, amplification of genes coding XL proteins during oogenesis. That means during oogenesis, XL proteins are required. That means the gene which will code for egg protein will be amplified. All the other genes will not be amplified, only the genes at that particular location will be amplified. This is the example of gene amplification. We're talking the example of fruit fly, amplification of genes coding XL proteins during oogenesis. That means during oogenesis, XL proteins are required in large quantity. That's why the gene coding for that XL protein will be amplified. That means larger copies of the same gene would be produced so that large amount of proteins can be formed from that. This is about the gene amplification. We'll see the example in our case also. The occurrence of gene amplification has also been reported in humans. Let's see. Methotrexate is an anti-cancer drug which inhibits the enzyme dihydrofolate reductase. Methotrexate is an anti-cancer drug which inhibits the enzyme dihydrofolate reductase. The malignant cells develop drug resistance to the long-term administration of methotrexate by amplifying the genes coding dihydrofolate reductase. That means in the cancer patients, we are using methotrexate so that this methotrexate can inhibit dihydrofolate reductase. But what sort of amplification is found? That means with the long-term use of this methotrexate, cancerous cells, they're amplifying the genes coding for dihydrofolate reductase. When they're amplifying the genes to code for dihydrofolate reductase, means large amount of dihydrofolate reductase would be produced. That's why methotrexate may not work at the long term. This is the example of also the application of gene amplification. We're talking about the gene amplification. It's like, so we know that all our cells consist of the same genes, and in some cells they are active, in other cells they are not active. And we also talked about the heterochromatin and euchromatin. And those genes, some genes are active in some stages of life and other genes are active in other stages of life. And one such example is due to the amplification. Example in fruit fly, amplification of the genes coding XL proteins occurs during oogenesis, because during oogenesis they require XL proteins to fulfill that need. The gene which codes for XL proteins are amplified. That means only that particular genes are amplified, not the other genes. And the gene amplification example in humans, now we have said methotrexate is an anti-cancer drug, and this methotrexate inhibits dihydrofolate reductase. In the long term, what happens? There is amplification of this dihydrofolate reductase gene so that this methotrexate will not be able to act because of the amplification of the genes of dihydrofolate reductase. Now, next is the gene rearrangement. There are gene rearrangements, also known as transposition of genes or somatic recombination of DNA. Transposition of genes, and sometimes they are also known as the jumping genes because they can jump from one DNA site to the other DNA site. Now we are talking here in terms of gene regulation. We are talking gene rearrangement, also known as the transposition of genes or somatic recombination of the DNA. The body possesses an enormous capacity to resynthesize a wide range of antibodies, and our body is able to synthesize a wide body of antibodies due to the process of gene rearrangement. There would have been no gene arrangement in our case, Nitin, we would not be able to produce so large amount of antibodies by our body. It is estimated that the human body can produce about 10 billion antibodies in response to antigen stimulation, and we are able to produce such large number of antigens in response to antigen stimulation because of gene rearrangement. Now let's see how gene rearrangement will occur. Now this is the variable region, this is the joint region, and this is the constant region. Okay, what type of region? This region we are talking in terms of light chain of immunoglobulins, the genes which code for the immunoglobulins. We know that the immunoglobulins are simply called antibodies. This gamma immunoglobulins, they consist of the light and the heavy chains, and both the light and the heavy chains, they have the N-terminal variable regions for the recognition of antigens. Now, how the gene rearrangement will be able to make such large number of antibodies, large types of antibodies, is there can be recombination. Let's see, this is the gene encoding heavy and light. This is about the light chain of immunoglobulins. Okay, a diagrammatic representation of gene rearrangement for the synthesis of light chain of immunoglobulin. Let's see, this is the variable region. This means gene switch code for the variable region. This gene switch code for the joint region. And this gene which codes for the constant region of the original DNA. And after rearrange, it can form so short segment, and this can be the primary transcript. That means this is first after the DNA is rearranged. It can be rearranged in a large number of ways so that 10 billion antibodies can be produced in response to the antigen. Okay, this is the original DNA, so large numbers are shown here. But now after they are rearranged to produce a small mRNA, this is the